So great, let's go ahead and get this funding and allocations party started. I mean, I'm surprised there aren't hundreds of people here who would want to miss this, right? I mean, but we are going to put the fun in funding. I'm just going to tell you that right now. So I am recording this LegReps Learn, so it will be available for other people to watch at a later date. So you all are the lucky ones who get to ask live questions and participate more actively with our speakers. We are going to have two guest speakers with us today. TJ Kelly from OSPI will speak first about various funding formulas. For some of you, you may find that that's elementary information because you have studied the prototypical school model in great detail, for which I am sorry. But for others of you, it may be brand new information. And so one of the goals of our LegRep Learns is to help engage all of our members, especially those of you who are joining us for the first time or are new to your board, new to your LegRep Learns position, and you're navigating what is probably one of the most complex systems that I'm aware of in our work, which is the funding and allocations system for funding our K-12 schools. So we're going to try to unpack a little bit of that with the experts today. So we have TJ Kelly from OSPI, and then following him, we will have Dan Steele from our partner organization, the Washington Association of School Administrators. He was in this seat, actually. He served in this same role with WASDA for about 13 years. You'll have to ask him back in the 70s or 80s, I think. I think he was in this job when I was born, maybe. I don't know. Maybe a little bit later. He's not here yet, so I can say those things. So while we're waiting for both of them to sign on, if you would please in the chat say the school district that you're representing today, maybe the number of years on the board that you've served. Your name will automatically pop up when you respond. So go ahead and just type in your school district and the number of years you served. So I probably should have introduced myself in case this is your first time. I'm Marissa Rathbone, otherwise known as WASDA Strategic Advocacy, part one and Logan's part two. I am your director, and you are gathered here with a team of really awesome professionals WASDA is representing. So I'd love for Logan to introduce himself, and then Daniel, and then if Brittany is here, want to have her turn on her screen and introduce herself. So Logan, why don't you kick it off first and say a little bit about your role?
Cool. Yeah. Thanks everybody for being here today. And again, happy Tuesday. I think we have one more this year. This isn't the last time. My name is Logan Endres. I am your strategic advocacy coordinator. And about my role, I do the same thing as Marissa. We're getting really excited right now for the beginning of legislative session in just over a month. January 10th will be here before we know it. Good to see you all.
Great. Daniel, would you introduce yourself? Talk a little bit about how you'll be supporting us moving forward.
So my name is Daniel Lunghoffer. I'm WASDA's accountant. And I come from a background working in school districts in the financial realm. I worked at OSPI for 6 years as a school accounting supervisor in a business office in a number of districts since then. And I am all about numbers and data presentations, number crunching. I'm one of those strange people that when Excel comes out with a new feature, I'm like, ooh, I get to play with something now. My way of supporting is, trying to take the complex information and present it in a way that people can understand, make it easier for people to understand who don't have that technical background. I try to basically take LegSpeak and turn it into English.
We feel so lucky to have Daniel on board. As he said, he was hired to be WASDA's accountant and is capable of doing that so well. We love getting paid and also so much more. So Logan and I are thrilled to have his brains be part of the strategic advocacy team, especially as we navigate this very complex topic. It's good to have somebody within the organization who understands it at an even deeper level than many of us do and to help us unpack. After our presenters go this afternoon, Daniel's going to come back and give you the opportunity to ask him some questions or really give some feedback on what it is that could help you navigate this complex arena better. Maybe ask him some questions or even give some suggestions to him and to us about what would help you moving into the legislative session following the presentations that we have. So also want to give Brittany an opportunity to introduce herself. Brittany, will you say a little bit about how you serve in your role?
Hi, I'm Brittany Montano. I am an administrative assistant here at WASDA. I support all the different branches in various aspects. I know I've seen a lot of you for Ledge Committee and Resolutions Committee. A lot of you have probably gotten emails from me at some point regarding something going on. And I enjoy, supporting all the branches and getting to know all of you.
Thanks so much, Brittany. So that's your WASDA team on board today, and we will be working with you very closely throughout the legislative session to respond to questions, to provide you with resources, to provide some technical assistance, whether that's how do you log in to the legislature online and sign in for a bill from your own prospective locations, or how do you log on to give testimony. We'll talk more before legislative session starts about what your role could be, either if you're representing WASDA from our legislative platform, or if you are representing your own school board, which may or may not have a different perspective sometimes than WASDA does. And you are welcome to do both, and we're happy to help you with each. So just know that we're here ongoing. So I'm still waiting, I think, for TJ from OSPI. Oh, nope, TJ is here. So TJ, if you wouldn't mind, turn on your screen. And we're so happy to have you here. I gave a little prompt that you would be joining, and you were going to help us unpack some really complex stuff in 20 minutes, the perfect amount of time to dig into these complex issues. I do have your presentation ready, but if you wouldn't mind just introducing yourself and your role, and then I'll pop that up whenever you tell me.
Sure. Thanks. I appreciate the invitation. My name's TJ Kelly. I'm the Chief Financial Officer with OSPI. I've been with the agency 12 years now. We kind of have a joke. Those of us that came in about the same time, we've been with the agency for 12 years, but we've been through enough legislative sessions for about 22. So I've been the Chief Financial Officer for about 3 years now. I came up as the Assistant Director of School Apportionment. I took the director role for about a year or two, and then transitioned to where I am today. So that is a little bit about me. So if you want to bring up the presentation, we can walk through this.
That's great. And what I'm envisioning, TJ, if you wouldn't mind, you can go through. For those of you who are participating, feel free to pepper questions in the chat. And then depending on how much time we have left, I can field some, or I won't field the questions. TJ will field the questions, but I will moderate by bringing them forward. So feel free to just be entering those questions as we go, so you don't forget what you're curious about in the moment.
All right, so what we're going to do here in the next 20 minutes is go over a very high kind of 10,000 foot overview of the prototypical school funding model, some of the main components of that model, what determines how much money school districts get. And then at the end of the presentation, we'll talk a little bit about things that we didn't go into in detail that we have other presentations on that would take, anywhere between 30 minutes and hours if you're that interested in it. So go ahead. So we're going to talk about the main factors that determine how much state funding school districts receive. We're going to talk about the basics of the prototypical model. And then towards the end, we'll touch on budget requests. One significant budget request and one significant request that was made a little bit later, but is still publicly out there. So next slide, please. So these are the general apportionment basic funding concepts. So the majority of the biggest factor in determining what how much funds your school district receives is based on the full-time equivalent enrollment that of the students it serves. And that enrollment is collected monthly by grade level and by program. And then the apportionment model takes that enrollment and it puts it through the funding formula, which first calculates staff units based on predetermined ratios in the state statute. And then we calculate salaries and benefits that go along with the assumption of those staff units. And then the last piece of the very basic concepts of funding is the MSOC allocation, the material supplies and operating costs, which is allocated on a per student basis. So we're going to touch on each one of these concepts as we walk through here. So student enrollment, as I said, it's the main driver of the funding that districts receive from the state. Student enrollment is reported to OSPI on a headcount and a full-time equivalent basis on each of the 10 monthly count days each year. So there's a specific date that's determined as the count date for each month, September through June. Districts report their enrollment to us. And in general, the funding is allocated based on the annual average of the full-time equivalent enrollment. In some cases, there are programs where the annual average headcount, not the full-time equivalency, is used, but much more common to base funding off of full-time equivalency rather than headcount. Next slide. The prototypical school model basically functions off of this concept that there's a fixed theoretical school size, and it's designed to target a certain number of student FTE in grade bands for formula purposes only. So as you can see on this slide, the prototypical school model has an elementary school of grades K through 6, and the assumption is that that school is comprised of 400 student FTE. Middle schools serve grades 7 and 8, and that those are comprised of 432 student FTE. And high schools are grades 9 through 12, and those are comprised of 600 student FTE. And the funding is generated based on the grade level that gets reported to OSPI, not necessarily where the grade resides within the classification at the school district. So when the model was put together, they did a study of grade bands and distribution of grade bands amongst school buildings in the state. And I think they determined that there were about 80 to 85 different combinations of grade bands within school buildings of the state. So in some areas of the state, sixth grade is middle school, but for funding formula purposes, those students generate through the elementary school prototypical model. Next. So as we all know, the prototypical school size starts with teachers, because teachers are fundamental to the education system and the operations of a school district. And the way the prototypical model allocates FTE units for teachers, or that are assumed to be teachers, is by using a class size. And this is an assumed class size, and with a few exceptions, there's nothing in the law that requires districts to actually achieve these class sizes. The one exception is, of course, the K-3 class size. So unless your school district actually offers a staff to student ratio of 17 in that grades K-3 band, then they wouldn't receive maximum funding from the state for that allocation. But the remainder of the class sizes on the chart here are for allocation purposes only. And many of these have remained consistent since the prototypical school model went into place back in 2011-12. Next, please. And then after we get beyond teachers, this slide represents the staffing ratios of the prototypical model that are intended to provide resources to serve the school in general. So you can see examples of these staffing units are principals, guidance counselors, teaching assistants, and on down the line. And you can see the ratios here are established by in each column. So for every 400 student FTE in grades K-6 that a district has, they're going to be allocated 1.253 FTE as principals. And you can see that in the far right-hand column of the table, each staff is identified as either certificated administrative staff, certificated instructional staff, or classified staff. And the reason why the funding model still does that is because, as we're going to speak to here in a minute, the salary and benefit model still functions with the premise of those three general staffing categories of CAS, CIS, and CLS. Next slide, please. So what this slide does is it basically, it flips those ratios on the previous slide on their head, so to speak. So on the previous slide, I mentioned that for every 400 elementary students, for every 400 FTE at an elementary school, there was 1.253 principals or whatever it was. And what this slide does is it says, how many students does it take to generate one FTE of each of these positions in the prototypical model? So in order to generate one school nurse for a 1.0 FTE school nurse, you need to enroll or you need to serve 5,263 FTE in grades K through six. So essentially your nursing to student ratio is 1 to 5,263. In middle school, that is 1 to 7,200. And in high school, it's 1 to 6,250. So a different way to think of this is, you know, essentially what is the caseload, if you will, of each of these staffing positions, if you assume that there's only one staff per prototypical school within the district. And then as we roll away from the school building and we look at services that are provided to the entire district, regardless of grade level or program, we come to district-wide support. And these allocations are based on 1,000 student FTE. So for every 1,000 full-time equivalent students enrolled, again, regardless of grade band or program, the district would be allocated 0.628 staff units for technology, 1.813 for facilities, maintenance, and grounds, and 0.332 for warehouse laborers and mechanics. And none of these ratios have changed since the funding model went into place back in 2011-12. Next slide. And then when we think about central administration and some of the other core functions of the model and of the system, the general theory here in the central administration allocation that the funding formula technical work group used to make the proposal to the legislature way back when is that the central administration supports the staff of the district. And as such, the allocation for central administration is based on a percentage of staffing units allocated in the prototypical model. Now, as I mentioned earlier, the school level staff units are based on student enrollment. So no matter how far back you want to track it, it all starts and ends with the number of students enrolled that you provide services to. But from a mechanical standpoint, the funding formula calculates central administration as 5.3% of the staffing units generated as K-12 teachers, school level staffing, and district-wide support. So if we ran all of the calculations that I've mentioned up until now in the presentation, and you got 100 staff units, 100 FTE, then you would get 5.3 FTE in central administration. And then that 5.3 FTE would be broken out into roughly 25% certificated administrators, which would be your superintendent-like positions. And then 75% would be classified, which would be more like your business office type positions. And central administration is not applied to, the percentage is not applied to some of the funding enhancements. It's just applied to the ratios that we've talked about thus far in the presentation. Go ahead, continue, please. So after we get through and we calculate the total number of staffing units that the funding model would allocate, based on the number of students enrolled, we do a calculation of salary and benefits. So allocations for salary and benefits are provided based on an assumed statewide average salary that is separately calculated for certificated instructional, administrative, and classified staff. And then some districts benefit from a multiplier, which is called a regionalization factor. And the regionalization factor is essentially a number that provides more salary and benefit allocation to districts with higher property values. And then in addition to the regionalization factor, some districts get what they call an experience mix factor, which is an additional 4% that's provided to districts that have above average educational and classroom experience represented in the certificated instructional staff units that they hire. And then the health benefits are provided based on a allocation per full-time equivalent unit. And then there's other benefit allocations that are provided based on a percentage of total salary. Next one, please. So basically, here's the numeric or the fiscal representation of everything I just walked through on that prior slide for the 21-22 school year. So you can see your three staff types at the top with the allocation values for base salary. You can see the regionalization factors on the second section there range from 1.0, which is no regionalization at all, to 1.24, which obviously is a 24% increase in the areas where the highest property values of the state are. The experience mix factor is represented as a 1.04 or 4%. And then you have your fringe benefit percentages and then your health benefit rates on the slide there at the bottom as well. And then finally, the last one of the that flow chart that I provided on the first slide is MSOC. And this is an allocation for material, supplies, and operating costs. And the first column there represents the allocation provided to all students based, well, it's generated or allocated based on 1.0 student FTE, regardless of program or grade band. So here you have $1,340.13 that's broken down into these distinct categories. And then for students in ninth through 12th grade, in addition to the $1,340.13, they also generate $184.09 that is intended to cover costs related to technology, curriculum and textbooks, other supplies, library materials, and instructional professional development. And this was part of the funding that came when the state shifted the credit requirement for graduation. This additional MSOC allocation for 9th through 12th graders was put in place. In addition to a class size enhancement for the lab sciences, which was referenced on one of the first slides in the presentation. And then again, at the bottom there, it talks about CTE and skill centers. So that's a program, one more forward, 1,585. So you can see in general education, it's 1,300 per kid roughly. And this shows that there's an MSOC enhancement for the CTE and Skill Center programs. And in the budget language, that's not broken out into any more specific categories than that single value there. Okay. So other critical areas of funding that we have a lot of detailed presentations on that we're not gonna go into today in the interest of time. So small school formula enhancements. If you have a small high school in your district, or if you're in a remote area that has a remote and necessary school, or if you just have enrollment below a certain threshold, there's additional funding that gets generated in the prototypical model. Special education funding for students with disabilities. Again, there's a complex model that goes along with that that we have more presentations on if you're interested. And then we have your categorical programs of learning assistance, transitional bilingual, and highly capable. And then we have your open doors, alternative learning experience, and your running start programs. Now, all three of them are funded by the running start rate, which is essentially the statewide average allocation for a student that's enrolled in the high school grades. So lots of other fun stuff here. If you wanna look further under the hood, either contact us or I can come back and walk you through any one of these at a future date. As we look at the OSPI budget request, the biggest budget request we have is a request for an increase in the allocation for nurses in the prototypical school model. And with that, we are requesting to institute a policy of staffing compliance across the broad category of social emotional learning services. So the nursing request in and of itself is a request to phase in incrementally over 3 school years to the nursing value that was represented in the class size initiative I-1351. And if the legislature chooses to do that, based on our current best estimates, it would be a $48 million cost in fiscal year 23. And then roughly, $300-ish million cost in the 23-25 biennium. And then that compliance piece would be in place to ensure that all allocations provided for social emotional learning for nurses, counselors, social workers, psychologists, family engagement coordinators, and potentially some others, we would want to make sure that the funding allocated for those services get spent on staff that actually provide those services within the district. And we're not really sure what that language looks like now. We're in active conversations with LEG staff on how to create that policy in bill language. And then our other budget requests are available online at that link. And then the next slide, please. The other one that's not on here is we are pursuing, and it's not on here because it's not an official budget request, but we are pursuing enrollment stabilization funding to help districts deal with the continued enrollment declines due to the pandemic. And at a very high level, what that is, it's a request for $522 million. And that funding is available in the current budget for K-12 schools that the legislature approved at the end of last legislative session. So essentially what we're asking them to do is honor the fiscal commitment they've already made to the K-12 system. And we do that through calculating the differential between this school year's enrollment and the enrollment that school district served in the 1920 school year as of October to kind of mitigate the impacts of student migration during the pandemic to private schools or homeschooling opportunities or other areas and means in which school students may have left the system. When this policy was addressed last legislative session, it started out as a bill and then the bill kind of disintegrated and it ended up in the budget. And when the legislature put it in place, they said, sure, we'll give you enrollment stabilization, but from that number, we're gonna deduct some of your federal emergency and secondary schools relief COVID aid money. And our ask of the legislature this session is to give that enrollment stabilization money in full without any offset of ESSER money or any other state or federal money. And we think that's essential. Now is not the time to cut funding for districts. We need an opportunity to recruit and retain staff more so now than ever, given some of the challenges that we've been facing this school year. So that was quick. I can be available for questions here, or I think my contact information got put in the chat. So Marissa and others certainly know how to find me if you need to track me down. So I'll pause for a second.
Very much, TJ. Appreciate that quick, high-level sort of overview of, again, a very complex issue. And I think we probably could have spent 15 to 60 minutes on each one of those individual slides trying to unpack each part. So not sure if folks had enough time to digest to ask a question. I invited folks to put any in the chat while we heard from TJ, and I don't see any. And we committed you till 12:30, TJ. So I don't want to, in the interest of time, I don't want to keep you too long. Like he said, his contact information is there. There would be an opportunity to bring him back to dig deeper into anything he previously discussed or introduced on that slide of other funding formulas. Also, in terms of the last reference to enrollment stability request, OSPI is requesting that through their budget request system. Also, Representative Dolan has already pre-filed a bill, which I included there in the chat for your review. We'll be supporting both throughout the process. We're also looking at a potential Senate version, a companion bill. So it will give us the opportunity to engage all of you in advocating for that budget stability with our legislators, but encourage you to do that in between now and then. And we'll talk a little bit more about the WASDA priorities document after we hear from our guest speakers. So I gave enough lead time for folks to ask questions. They didn't take me up on it, TJ. So thank you so much for being with us and look forward to continuing the conversation. Appreciate all you're doing and your leadership from OSPI.
No problem. Thanks for the invitation. Have a good meeting.
Thanks, TJ. All right. Well, with that, again, in the interest of time, we invited our friend and colleague from WASDA, Dan Steele, who I consider a friend and one of my favorite partners outside of WASDA. Dan always picks up the phone or responds to a text message when I call him and provides good information and detail about what we need to know in order to advocate on your behalf. So really appreciate the partnership with WASDA and Dan at the helm there, and looking forward to hearing a little bit from Dan about WASDA's priorities and then School Funding Coalition, and then anything else you really want to share with us, Dan. The floor is yours, and I did give you co-host capabilities, so you can lead your PowerPoint.
Excellent. First off, just thank you, Marissa, for the invitation. Is that okay? You seeing that? Okay, good. I was had a problem with an issue. Anyway, appreciate the opportunity to have this conversation. As Marissa said, you know, we have multiple conversations throughout the week, throughout the days during the session. We work very closely together, and I think it's really important not only for us to be colleagues, but also our associations. I work for the superintendents and administrators. She works for you, the school board members, and obviously, that's an important linkage locally. We think it's also important for our associations to work closely together too. So again, appreciate the opportunity. I'm just gonna walk through at a fairly high level, fairly quickly, WASDA's legislative platform, and then also talk about the School Funding Coalition, and then also just kind of talk about some long range kind of additional issues. Part of the reason that Marissa wanted me to talk about the WASDA platform is as you go through this and you look at your own platform, you will notice some very serious commonalities. And part of the reason our associations work so well together and Marissa and I work so well together, and I should add Logan in there too. We don't want to forget him. He's an important partner as well. But you'll walk through and you'll see some very similarities between our priorities and yours. So let me just go ahead and jump through this. And I want to mention the first thing, for the last several years, WASDA has really tried to maintain the consistency of our platform. Oftentimes there are some unique issues that we have to add on a given year. But if you look back for the last 5 or 6 or 7 years, most of our priority items are consistent. And part of the reason we do that is if you ask for something 1 year and then you drop it off your list the next year, and then the third year you bring it back, you have this yo-yo effect and it confuses legislators about what we really want, what our priorities are. And I know WASDA's system is a little bit different given the legislative assembly. And by the way, I think most of you know this, but I work for WASDA for about 13 and a half years. So I have intimate knowledge about your process and how you operate. So we do things a little bit differently, but again, we do think it's important to maintain some consistency. The other thing in the last several years, we've really decided to take a strategy to make sure that we actually ask for what we really think school districts need to operate. In the legislative arena, there's oftentimes strategies about, you know, we're not going to be able to achieve this particular item, so let's ask for less than what we really need so we can actually check off a win in our box. We don't think that that's helpful. Again, it also confuses legislators. So, for example, if you have a program that's going to cost you $200 million across the state. But you know that the legislature is not going to provide $200 million. So you say, let's just ask for $100 million. Well, there's a couple of things you need to be aware of. If you don't ask for the $200 million, there's no way in God's green earth that you will ever get the $200 million. You might actually get your lower ask of $100 million, but even if you do that, you'll collect that money and then you'll say, but you know what? We still don't have what we need, which forces you then to go back to the legislature and say, hey, we need another $100 million. That confuses legislators. They say, well, wait a minute, you asked for $100 million. We gave you $100 million. What's going on here? So we've really taken the approach that we need to ask for exactly what we need to run our school districts to make sure that we can have appropriate programs for our students and appropriate salaries for staff and all the rest of it. Now, obviously, during the legislative session, we do have some pragmatic strategies that we actually work through to get what we can. But top line, we actually ask for what we really think we need. We're also in this game, kind of playing for the long haul. Many of our issues are major funding issues, and we know that in one session, it's not going to be able to be achieved, which is part of the reason we maintain that consistency, asking for it year in and year out until we actually achieve that success. So our platform, we've really, like most of you, most of our associations have developed our platform looking through that lens of equity. That's a very important issue, has been for a number of years, but it's elevated in the last few. These are our six priorities. I'm not going to talk about them here. You can see down at the bottom, there's a link for you to go to our full one pager, but just want to walk through each of these issues again, kind of fairly quickly. The first thing is asking for an update to staffing allocations as a part of the prototypical school funding model. This is easy to talk about because TJ just walked through a bunch of this information. But again, we want to make sure that the legislature actually achieves what they've committed to, which is taking the prototypical school funding model, which was developed in 2010, and make sure that we actually have appropriate, realistic state-funded staffing levels. TJ mentioned that those numbers that are a part of the prototypical school funding model have been fairly consistent over the years. That's a polite way of saying the legislature hasn't actually made any changes or virtually no changes to the model or the ratios. When the legislature adopted this prototypical school funding model in 2010, they laid out a commitment to actually regularly review and regularly update, and they just haven't done that. In 2014, Initiative 1351 went out to the people, basically forcing the legislature to actually achieve those necessary updates. Well, one of the first things the legislature did after that passed overwhelmingly was to actually freeze those numbers. And then in 2017, when they adopted House Bill 2242, the so-called McCleary solution, they actually repealed those numbers. But then they also required OSPI to develop a staffing work group to actually come up with some recommendations. So that's probably more than you needed there, but we really think this is a very important thing. Again, this is one of those issues that's going to be a long-term issue. We know the legislature is not going to be able to update this to the ultimate level for a number of years. It's going to cost $6 or $7 billion to do that. And so certainly the legislature is not going to be able to do that overnight. TJ talked about the issue that they have in as OSPI's decision package, supporting full funding for nurses over the next 3 years. We're actually supporting that, again, as that pragmatic short-term request. And I think what TJ mentioned about also providing that flexibility within that bucket of health and social services, we think is really important. We're looking for nurses fully funded, but hopefully if the legislature also adopts that package request, it's also going to have that flexibility. So you can use nurse dollars for psychologists or social workers or counselors, other things that are a part of that box. These are the numbers that they walk through. And I also, I apologize. I got the numbers wrong in the budget request. This is an old slide, so I'll have to update that. Use TJ's numbers for that budget request. You also have down there the link to this request too, so you can get all the details. Also want to let you know, kind of as a side note, WASA and WASDA don't do this stuff alone. We work with our partners very closely. The School Funding Coalition is comprised of 7 statewide organizations, management organizations, that have come together to support issues that we can all rely on. And the School Funding Coalition has made a commitment to have our almost singular focus be looking for those updated staffing ratios in the prototypical school funding model. We just developed our priority statement the first part of August or middle of August. You can see down at the bottom right, there's a link to that one pager which walks through the details of our request. If you haven't seen that yet, I believe Marissa is going to be sending that out soon. But if you want to get a preview, check that out. Again, this is going to be a major priority, not only for us, not only for WASDA, but as well as all of these other associations. So continuing on, this is another one of those very consistent asks in terms of equitable and ample education resources. When the McCleary solution was adopted, there was the claim that we are now fully funded, everything's taken care of, we have equitable funding. Well, we know that it's not fully funded and we know that it's not equitable. In fact, House Bill 2242 actually made some issues worse in terms of equity. So we've got a number of issues that we're focusing on this year. First of all, is dealing with the underfunded pupil transportation funding model. Had legislation will be on the table to actually transform the STARS formula. We also are very concerned about special education. The legislature has done a really good job of providing additional resources for special education, but they're still woefully far from full funding of special education. One of the clearest basic education items in our system, and they haven't actually met that need. We also are concerned about regionalization and the experience factor, pieces that were put in to actually increase your level of funding in certain circumstances. We think the way the regionalization was rolled out, a number of districts were left out. Same thing with the experience factor, and there's gonna be legislation on the table to deal with the experience factor this next year, House Bill 1419. And then the regionalization issue is probably gonna be dealt with in the salary base rebase committee that OSPI is putting together currently. And then the fourth piece, this is one we really put on our agenda through the pandemic, and we're going to continue asking for additional technology resources. And what we're looking for is both devices and connectivity, but not only the availability of those, but also the affordability of it. We know that there are some families that actually have broadband that comes right up to their doorstep, but they can't actually access it because they can't afford it. Advancing equity is a new issue for us. We've been working on equity for a number of years. This is the first time we've actually put it on our platform, asking for additional tools and flexibility and resources to make sure that we can provide learning opportunities that are equitable for each student in our system, as well as those same tools and flexibility resources to recruit, retain, and then also support effective staff that actually look like the diversity of our students. Investing in learning and recovery, this is another major budget ask. The legislature did a really good job in this last session of providing millions of dollars, both in federal funds as well as state funds, to assist school districts in this learning recovery as students went through the pandemic. The concern we have, though, is almost all of that money from federal dollars and state dollars is one-time money. So once the money's gone, it's gone. And we think that this is not going to be a one-and-done situation. We think the learning recovery is going to take us a number of years. And so we're asking to either sustain what we currently have at the bare minimum, if not actually enhance the resources that are being provided. Capital facilities, both WASA and WASDA, this has been on our priority list for a number of years. First off, we think it's high time. In fact, it's been 20 years, 30 years, it's been high time for the legislature actually to give our voters the opportunity to determine whether or not they want to have school bond issues be adopted by a simple majority. Another long-term issue, unfortunately, there will probably be legislation this year, but it's going to be difficult to get that over the bar. And then also similar to the prototypical school funding model that has staffing ratios that don't meet the need, we also have school construction formulas that just flat don't meet our needs. The legislature, again, has done a good job of fully funding the formulas for school construction. But the problem is if the formula doesn't fully fund, it doesn't matter if they fully fund the formulas or not. And so the funding we receive as state match doesn't actually meet actual school construction costs, nor the educational space needs we have in terms of labs and other assorted things. So that's our platform. There are a couple additional issues that I just want to mention that TJ also talked about, but enrollment stabilization, this is going to be a major priority for us pushing through. What we're concerned about is that legislators are going to look at the number of ESSER dollars you have, and they're also going to be looking at your ending fund balances. And we've got to come up with a great story of why ESSER dollars are used for something other than backfilling enrollment. Same thing with your ending fund balances, that those mostly are dedicated to things out in the future. And so we really encourage you to develop your stories about those issues, because this is going to be a hard ask to get a win. The other thing, we're also looking for some help in staffing stability. Most of you are aware of the retire, rehire laws that were in place for a number of years. This kind of extends that. Currently, if you retire, you can come back to work, but you're capped at the number of hours you can actually work until it impacts your pension. We're hoping that we can actually extend or waive those rules to make sure that especially our classified staff, our bus drivers, our janitors, educational associates across the board, and even some teachers, we might be able to find some additional people to come into our system and help us out. So that's all I've got for you. I do just want to mention a couple of things before I turn it back to Marissa. It's going to be really important for us to be very active during this session. I'm sure you've heard that from Marissa over and over and over, and you're going to hear it from me as well. It's really important that we actually maintain activity on the Hill. Make sure you get to know your legislators if you haven't already. Meet with them on a regular basis. I don't know if Marissa's talked to you about this or if you're aware of it yourselves already, but we're going to have a virtual session again, which means meeting with legislators via Zoom. By the way, that's probably easier access for folks, especially those in Eastern Washington. You don't have to go over the snowy passes. It's a lot easier to do that. So we encourage you to keep up that level of activity. So I could probably go on at some other things, but let me just go ahead and stop there, see if there's any questions. And I'm not sure how much time I have. I might actually be out of time, but I'll take questions for however long you have.
What I told you you'd be dedicated to, but I know Martha Rice from Yakima has a question. Can you stay with us to at least answer that? Martha, floor is yours.
Thanks, Marissa. Dan, it's good to see you. Thank you for taking the question. This has to do with the prototypical school model, its inequities, and why are we not pursuing a model that really is based on equity, as opposed to some generic pretend school and pretend kids that I don't know that there is such a thing as a prototypical school across the state.
Well, I think the short answer to that is the prototypical school funding model provides a base level And then there's other resources that are available in terms of special education, in terms of LAP funding, in terms of highly capable, that sort of thing. I do understand the question and I know the concern. As difficult as it's going to be to actually achieve what we're looking for in terms of adequate staffing resources in the model, it's going to be that much more complicated and difficult to actually get to the question that you're asking. So not to say that we can't ask for it, but I think in terms of the base level funding, if we get that achieved sometime in the next 5 to 10 years, I think then we can build upon that in the future. You know, when it was a tough row to hoe for the legislature to actually adopt this prototypical school funding model. And over the last 10 years, they've done virtually nothing to change it. In the way that you're talking about, completely overhauling the model is going to be a huge lift. So not to say that it's wrong, not to say that we can't or won't ask for it, but I think that's a huge lift that will probably be a secondary item.
Thanks, Dan.
You bet. Thank you. Marissa, I didn't put in my PowerPoint my contact information, but I saw you did that for TJ. If you want to put that in there in the chat box, would take any calls or emails from folks after we're done here today.
Sounds good. I'll enter that in the chat now. Looks like you have a couple more questions, though. Are you okay to stay for a couple more minutes?
Yeah, I'm good as long as you've got time for it.
I think it's important and love having your voice here. Question from Karen Chase out of Edmonds. Can you speak to collaborating with our counties as a strategy to access additional funding?
You know, I think that's a great thing to do. We strongly encourage school districts to work with our cities and counties and other local governments. There's a way to actually have economies of scale, to actually share buildings, to share resources, especially in terms of the ESSER dollars that have come down. Counties have dollars that I know in a number of counties, they've actually gone straight to their school districts and say, we're gonna give you a portion of this to do community staffing for whatever the case may be. Community-based organizations as well. And one side note, I'll let you know that Marissa and I both are a part of what we call the Local Government Coalition, which is comprised of schools, counties, cities, ports, library districts, hospital districts, PUDs, all of those 2,500 local governments across the state. And we work with them pretty closely on issues of commonality. But at your local level, certainly, I would encourage you to actually meet with those community-based organizations, as well as your cities and counties, and see what you can collaborate on.
Thanks, Dan. Another question from Diane Sunvik from Kennewick.
Hi, Dan. Thanks for taking the extra time. You mentioned the additional funding for special education, ostensibly on top of we have now, but the big push, as you well know, is to have our special education students included in general ed classes for the majority of their day. So how does that, you know, how will you be working that into it? Because that adds then more need for teachers and other staff members to be included in those classes.
Right. And the legislature's really pushed hard on this inclusionary practices problem. And so there are efforts to provide additional resources, even for those students that are actually in the general ed class. In fact, if you look at the model, kids that are in the general ed class for 80% of their time or more get more funding than those students that are isolated. So I think that's part of the issue. Even if a student is in a general ed class, if they are a special ed student with very special needs, they are going to need additional resources, whether it be additional time or additional staff helping them. So they do have to say, all special ed kids, they are a general education student first. So the per pupil student allocation that you receive, all special ed students receive that same allocation. And then on top of that, they receive that special ed education allocation. So I'm not sure if that answers the question or not.
But not really, right. real briefly, because I spent 40 years as a speech language pathologist. So I understand all the 80, 40, 60% stuff, which never was enough anyway. But now that when you're talking about our special, our kids with extra needs, you know, some severe needs,
sure.
Just because we include them in a classroom does not mean that's the least restrictive environment, right? They need additional resources, whatever that may be. So I don't see any funding being added for those particular needs.
Well, and to be honest with you, that's part of what we've been asking for the last several years. We do know that there are kids that really do have unique needs that are very expensive. There's the safety net process, which it's cumbersome and it doesn't quite do the trick. But if we actually had quote unquote fully funded special education, it would help. Maybe not all of those kids, but at least it's a start. But the legislature continues to come back to us whenever we ask about full funding. They say, look at how much we provided in the last 3 or 4 years. And we say, thank you, we appreciate that, but it's not enough.
Right. So, well, keep going. Thanks. I appreciate it.
Thank you.
We'll keep going together on that. It's been a consistent priority of WASDA membership as well since I've been here and certainly years before that. So our legislators know that it's a priority for our membership and we bring up the conversation every time we talk with them and it would encourage you to do the same. One more question from Dave Larson out of Tukwila.
Thank you. To go on a little bit on what Martha was saying, so you said it's a really hard political lift to interject equity into the prototypical model. I guess my question is, I've asked OSPI several times, you know, what's their number one priority? And they you know, say closing the opportunity gaps and achievement gaps and things like that. And how can we possibly do that unless, you know, the basic funding model supports putting resources where the student needs are?
Yeah, Dave, I know this has been an issue near and dear to your heart for a long time, and I appreciate you continuing to be your head against the wall on this one because it really is important. I don't know how to address that other than what you just said. It really is important to make sure that the dollars get to the kids in the right way. And we'll just keep pushing on that. And I said it jokingly, but I really appreciate you continuing to wave that flag because it's a message that needs to be heard.
Thanks, Dan. You had a nice sprinkling of questions there all over the place. Thanks for fielding all of them, being ready for it. I think if you're okay heading out, or you're welcome to stay. I think the next 30 minutes, just so you all know, we've allocated another 30 minutes. I know that some of you might have to return to work or have another commitment at 1 o'clock. That's fine. This will be continuing to record for the next 30. What we plan to do from here is bring back up the WASDA legislative priorities, make some meaning out of that. And then Daniel is going to engage you in a dialogue and some Q&A about how we can best support you as it relates to these topics moving towards the legislative session and throughout. Another thing just to note, I think Dan will back me up on this too, is that we're in the second year of a biennium, which means that big budget asks are more well received if they are well received ever, but at the first year of a biennium. So these are conversations that we need to continue to be having throughout 2022 in preparation for the first year of the biennium, which will start in 2023. Largely speaking, this next session, because it's a short session, is a little bit more corrective in nature. It's literally called the supplemental, which means that they're just supplementing what they might have missed, making some course corrections and adjustments. Rarely do big budget pockets get funded in this year of a biennium. But like Dan said, continuing the conversations and bringing up what's important is a priority to both of our organizations. Okay, I put Dan's contact information in there, but he can always join us again during Ledge session when we continue our Ledge Rep Learns. Appreciate you being here, Dan. Thank you for the insights. All right, so let me go ahead from here, and hopefully you all have seen this. We are gonna just take a quick look again at our 2022 legislative priorities. I really like the way Dan framed the consistency, the importance of having consistency of platform. I wouldn't say that we've done that intentionally, but it has been purely by the prioritization process that you all hopefully have participated in, or your districts have, that just by nature of your interests and your priorities, we see a lot of consistency from year to year in terms of our legislative priorities. Emerging to the top over the course of the last few years has been mental health, comprehensive student safety. That certainly has been top of mind for all of you and is reflected here in our top priorities. The way that this document comes to you is following General Assembly, you participate in a prioritization process, and then we take those legislative priorities, usually the top 20, and figure out a way to combine them in a way that reflects a large swath. What is also true of our legislative platform is that many of our legislative positions, and you should note that we currently have 133 of them, consist of a lot of overlap. So in the case of this year's prioritization process, the top three positions were actually directly related to staffing allocations and budget stability. So what we did was take that prioritization and those positions and collapse some of them so that we could bring forward a more succinct and easy to read document, which is what you see here in front of you. Hopefully you receive this either at annual conference, through the in-session listserv that we send out on a regular basis, or through a member update, but I will also upload it into the chat so that you can download it. So there are good words on here. These words are yours. We pulled them directly from the legislative positions and organized them in a way that was easy to read. And so what we have, what our work is, should have been throughout the interim, but especially going into the legislative session, is how do we tell the story? What are the stories and what is your actual data that demonstrates to your legislators the importance of improved health and safety, additional needs for resources for special ed, funding that reflects what your current needs are, and that's related to not just COVID response and learning recovery, but also in terms of staffing allocations, what actually you need and is ample and equitable as it relates to basic education. Recognizing, Dan referenced this too, is that we are actually fully funded based on the current prototypical school model. So when you use language like you need to fully fund basic education, the fact of the matter is based on the current model, they are fully funding basic education. What we really need is an adjustment to that prototypical school model to better reflect your needs. So that's the work that we keep talking about, prototypical school formula funding adjustments. And some work that our organizations were part of under the staffing enrichment work group. We can talk more about that, but in essence, that staffing enrichment work group laid out a phased in approach by which we prioritized mental health and safety first in that phase one. So by nature of honoring the OSPI budget request, hopefully in this next session to increase the allocation for school nurses, legislators will be moving gradually in sync with the request that we've made from that staffing enrichment work group recommendation. If you ever want to dig more into that, I'm happy to do it. It is an 80-page document, so there's lots of content in there, and we could surface the most important parts, at least by phase. And then always we include capital facilities. I will tell you that your prioritization this year put school construction revenue as number 20. So it just barely made the cut. And simple majority wasn't listed at all in your top 20. So I kind of circumvented the prioritization process a little bit, but I was reading your minds and I just knew that you would want simple majority on this document, even if you didn't tell me you did through the prioritization process. It's an easy thing to forget, I think, because it's something we've been battling for so long, but it is reflected here in this document because we need healthy schools, healthy learning environments that are contemporary and safe so that our students can learn. And we need a way to pass those bonds to do it effectively and more quickly than many of your communities have been able to. So you've got your priorities up here. I think I saw a question in chat. Logan, would you mind telling me what that question might have been? Maybe it's me, maybe it's Dan, maybe it's a collective.
It's actually not a question, just some thank yous from Sarah Bettnell and Rebecca Stillings, who both had to jump off or are jumping off.
Excellent. Thank you both for being here and for thanking us for our work. We appreciate it. We love what we do, so it's good stuff. I'm going to upload that document so you have a copy of it if you don't already. So happy to field questions about that, but I think the next step really is to give Daniel the floor to speak a little bit in more detail about supporting you in this space. Logan and I are certainly your strategic advocacy team, and we'll be working with you to figure out ways to access advocacy opportunities, whether that's through writing your legislators, providing testimony, having meetings with your legislators, and we can join if you want our support there, we're happy to. Daniel will really be the key person with WASDA working behind the scenes to analyze the bills as they come forward and the budget provisos, and then crunching the numbers so that you can make meaning out of them. There are lots of words in all of those documents, and luckily Daniel loves to read them and help make sense out of them for you. So Daniel, I'd give you the floor to sort of lead some Q&A if you'd like, or ask some questions directly of our members that might be of interest to you.
Okay, yeah. Let me just start off by saying that, yeah, you know, I'm here to help in just about any way that I can. You know, I'm here to be a resource and in addition to things like, you know, OSPI's pivot tables, you know, Dan Steele's TWIO, you know, I will never replace those documents, but as, you know, as a supplemental to them, definitely more than willing to help. For example, as I once told OSPI, I may or may not have copied their prototypical funding Excel model when I left them, when I stopped working for them. I can neither confirm nor deny that I still have a copy of this model. One of the things that I can do, for example, OSPI, when the governor's budget comes out, they'll produce a pivot table. Well, the pivot table will show you this is how much total funding your total funding will change. What I would be able to do is, you know, hopefully using the same numbers that OSPI uses for enrollment, break it down and say this is how much, you know, this is, you know, where your district will see funding increases. This is exactly what it means for your district. So being able to break it down to that district level, that's one thing that I can do. Not necessarily, you know, if anyone wants it, but, you know, there's an option. And then also just helping to provide, you know, my interpretation of what a bill says. You know, again, it'll be supplemental to things like the TWIO. And certainly, you know, I am not going to say that I am an authoritative measure on how to read things, but it is, you know, this would be my perspective. This is how I think this reads.
Thanks, Daniel. Can you tell us what TWIO stands for?
TWIO is This Week in Olympia. You know, it comes out every week. Dan Steele does a lot of work on it. I'm sure others at WASDA do. And if you aren't subscribed to it, subscribe to it, because it presents a very good summary of everything that went on in Olympia. You know, bill analysis, you know, this is, you know, they'll say this is what we spoke for, spoke against, or things like that. But it's a very good resource and well worth the time to subscribe and read every week. Shameless plug.
I provided a link there to Dan's website, which is actually their legislative page. And just a nice thing for you to know, thankfully we get to work with Dan and credit him where credit is due, where words are brought forward. Dan is able to provide more of a narrative and a complex overview of the bills that come forward. And this works well because he has such a deep knowledge. So it makes sense that he would translate it in this way. Whereas Logan and I have traditionally provided more of a high level overview that's a little bit more accessible to some new members. Also, that makes sense for us because we're still learning so much too. So luckily, together, you've got a collective team who can provide you different access points to this information. So feel free to build from both and learn from both and ask us how to make sense of it if you need that kind of guidance. I would be curious from all of you now, thank you, Daniel, for offering some things. I would be curious to hear from you if you have some feedback. You can just type comment or question in the chat. Something that would be helpful for you. We just went through a lot of information, a complex matter. What do you need in order to feel equipped to engage in the legislative session and even before with your legislators on these topics? I'm going to let you go ahead and type comment in there. Would love to hear a question from you. In the meantime, I did see that Jim Stauffer had sort of a response, I think, to Dan's prompt that we need to be able to tell the stories. So while you are all thinking about what you need from us, Jim, would you elevate that story for us?
Yes. And thank you, Dan, for your work. And it's always good to see you here. So, SQIM, in a portion of our ESSER dollars, we have allocated an amount to fund a installation of an elevator into our district building, which is 1945 era, which I think was original high school, but it never had an elevator. And so a couple of our community outreach programs are on the second floor. And at one time our HR department was on that second floor. And so there was no ADA access. And so it's, you know, an equity issue. And so we, fortunately, we were also working a capital projects levy campaign. So if the ESSER dollars didn't apply, we were going the other route too. But we're installing this elevator now, and it will allow access to students and family to that second floor in a more safe environment. And we eventually also will put our boardroom up there into which used to be a classroom, and it will be a whole double classroom type thing. But I think it was a very wise and strategic use, and then thinking outside of the box of where you can utilize those funds. And don't know the completion date yet, but it is I think it's in the contractor solicitation stage right now. But that was so I can work on a story for you, Dan and Marissa, and we can get some video, we'll put that together
sometime. Thanks, Jim. One of the things we did recently discuss amongst the education advocates and lobbyists is just the importance to continue to illuminate the positive stories. We all have endured a lot over the last couple of years, and it's really easy to just stay stuck in what's wrong. So in order to move from what's wrong to how we can do what helps or what's right, we need some examples of what you hope to achieve, or what maybe you or another neighboring district has achieved that has helped address some of the problems that we're bringing up. So we need to come forward with some solutions, and those positive stories are part of that approach. Thank you, Sandy, for being willing to make a comment. And you are hopefully you're sitting still. You're parked.
I am not driving. I'm stopped. See, yes. Their car is not moving. Okay. So unfortunately, this is not a positive, but to that request. So I know I'm joined by our fellow districts in pain of Edmonds, and Shoreline was here, and I don't think we have anyone from Mukilteo, but the school shooting threats, this is our first day since last Tuesday where we don't have a high school in lockdown. due to school shooter threats. And so the mental health catastrophe that our students are dealing with is just over the top. And so I'm wondering, I know that for the districts that got ESSER dollars, we weren't one of them, but I lost my friend Brian Giannini Upton to share that. But if we could gather that data of how much money we're having to spend on mental health for our students, and to Martha's point earlier on the prototypical school model, I think if we can provide that data of this is how much we're having to spend for mental health for our students as we transition from the pandemic crisis to back to the school shooting crisis, that I think that could be a really powerful argument to that prototypical school model and the need for it to be updated.
That's great, Sandy. What a great suggestion. What I'd be curious to know, if you don't know if your school district is tracking that kind of data in terms of how much are you spending on mental health, please find out and get back. If you know that your district is tracking that and feel confident that you could have a conversation sooner rather than later with myself and Logan, would you type your district in the chat and maybe a phone number if you're willing to have me reach out to you? That would be excellent. This is the kind of way that I envision we'll use these LedRepLearn spaces, is surfacing these kinds of issues, examples of what might be brought forward, and then having you prepared to either ask the question and then return with, yeah, we can do that, or be ready to volunteer so that we can take action pretty quickly. That would be super helpful. Jim has a comment. Go ahead, Jim.
Yes, thank you again. I'm going to suggest the video that's on Tim and the 125 things we have done since March 13th, that we perhaps share that out through all organizations type thing, just that helps tell the story as a gift wrap to the legislators, county commissioners, so forth. Another item I'm thinking at both Diane's and somebody else's comment about working with your county and how to testimony. At the annual conference, there was a work session that was a collaborative from Essequad, North Shore, Shoreline, Bellevue, Mercer Island school districts, and where board directors got together and formed an outreach group. And I think that was very helpful because they reached out across the board to other elected entities and to tell the story of public education. And so I think those are all available now for review. If you attended annual conference, or even if you didn't attend the conference, they're available. So very helpful. And I think last year we learned about how to do testimony via remote. And I think that was very beneficial because now we were able to get our student voice there, and they didn't have to hop in a van and drive over the mountains or down 101, so forth. And so those are a lot of opportunities. I know Logan is coordinating that student voice, student focus. So I would encourage districts to reach out with their students to Logan on those and follow the weekly updates and also talk to your director area led reps. Thank you.
That was a good long list, Jim. You're hired. Your first idea about Tim's 125 things, if you didn't see that or you weren't at annual conference, he spent a significant time laying out the variety of topics that we covered in our weekly networking calls, starting with the beginning of COVID. And there were 125 things. I don't know about you, but after listening to just 50 of them at annual conference, I was ready to take a nap. And I didn't even have to implement them like you did. So it was illuminating to hear them listed. OPMA might have been mentioned a few times, but I think we get like 20 OPMAs at least throughout the course of the year. So I put a link to the video there in the chat. Diane, what a great idea. So Diane's suggesting here that we might provide some more technical assistance and guiding on how to provide testimony. We are happy to do that. Could you speak a little bit more to what might help you feel more comfortable?
I'm not sure I would feel uncomfortable, but people who have not done it before or are not comfortable speaking to the legislature. And Marissa, last year you gave us a little overview of how to do that. You have a very short period of time and that time can be shortened. So you have to have the short and the shorter version of what you want to say. And you have to say it very fast and you have to practice over and over so you can say it very fast. And I just think it would be very helpful, you know, like role-playing kinds of things or just a quick, maybe a video of last year, how someone did it very effectively, because it seems scary. On Zoom, it's not, because you don't have to be in front of all those people, but it still seems scary to a lot of people. And so I just think seeing it, practicing it, makes it a little easier.
I love that idea. I particularly love the idea. We can pull some recordings from TVW from last year of school board members actually delivering testimony. So we could take some clips of some best practices and sort of unpack what it means to give good testimony remotely. Short and to the point is always very good. You might have 2 minutes, but it's always better if you just take one.
Yeah. And I think, 1 minute is 150 words, Sandy says, but that depends on how quickly you speak. That's and you have to speak quickly, but not so quickly. So that there's a real ratio thing there, brain-wise, about what people can pick up. But I also think, and I've heard this multiple times, bringing something, showing something, having students, you know, students speaking, obviously, Jim, you know, that's very important. But when we are speaking about board numbers, that's boring to them, actually. But if you can show like little pictures of how many students that would actually be and how many wouldn't be seen by a nurse that we know are not seen by nurses, if we get a quarter of a nurse for a high school every fifth day or something, those are the kind of things that they really can see, not just the numbers. And then maybe you could also speak on that about how you don't have to go in front of the big scary legislature. You can just check in and say, I concur, or, you know, pro, con, whatever. That I think that's helpful, especially for all of us, but especially our new people who don't know at all how to do that maybe.
Yeah, the sign-in process is fairly benign, and you can put your school district's name if your board has agreed to a position on a bill. Yeah, you can definitely just sign in and have more of a passive support. You can also send in communications. Do know that the volume of emails our legislators were getting last year was enormous. So again, keeping things short and sweet and using a variety of communication tactics is probably our best bet. And you should just also know that for any legislative position, for any bill that comes forward and WASDA has a legislative position on it, Logan and I will engage in some way. We may take a more passive approach if it wasn't one of your priorities, but we will take an active approach for any of the topics that were on that one pager, which means we are, for any of those, we are already in conversation with legislators about all of those topics already. Okay,